Welcome to Seriscapedia. My name is Chuck. I'm doing my research so you don't have to. This is part of a series of videos on plant identification. You can watch the rest of the series by checking out this playlist, which should appear somewhere around here, or by looking at the link down in the description. Common names versus scientific names. Now, if you're part of any online succulent community, then I'm sure you've seen your own fair share of ID requests, or maybe even put up some of your own. Or if you're new to this, an ID request is where people post photos of their plant and hope someone else would identify it for them. So in this transaction, what one hopes to gain is the name of the plant that they have. Most of the time, there would be at least one person who would know, and usually people would respond either with a common name or scientific name. And if you're lucky, maybe even both. Now, which one is better, the scientific or common name? Well, like many other things, this can be quite subjective. Personally, I find that I prefer the scientific name over the common name. But there are many others who might find the scientific names intimidating or maybe even obnoxious. To each their own. Each system has its advantages and disadvantages. And luckily, these two things are not mutually exclusive. You don't have to choose between one or the other, you could have both. Here are some of the advantages of common names. The first one, of course, would be that it would be easy to understand and everyone knows this. A good example of this would be the great white shark. Its scientific name is Carcharodon carcharias. Practically speaking, it's a lot faster just saying out shark or great white shark. That's a maximum of 3 syllables. While if you go with the scientific name, then that would be Carcharodon carcharias. 8 syllables. So it's taking a lot of time. Well, in informal communication, just saying shark or great white would be enough. Everybody knows what you're talking about. And to be honest, when you're in the water with a great white shark, would you yell the scientific name? No.
Carcharodon carcharias!
Awkward. I think by the time you say its full name, it would have already bitten you.
Ow!
The second advantage that I've listed is that it is not intimidating. Let's say you are at a landscaping center looking to replace or lay down some fresh lawn. And what if everyone was using scientific names? Let's try imagining it. Hey man, I'm looking to lay down some lawn in my backyard. What do you have for me? Yes sir, we are running specials on some of our range. And here's our more popular ones. If you're looking for a cheap and fast way of growing your lawn, then you'd like Penicetum clandestinum. Or if you're looking for something a bit less invasive, we have the Botelua dactyloides. If you can spare the budget, we have Elymus repens. Or if you want something a bit tall, then you won't go wrong with Festuca arundinacea. Another thing I like about common names is that they are very interesting, rich in culture and history. There's a story behind the name. And because of that, some would have different names in various languages and traditions. And a fourth reason is that some of the common names are so cool. Take for instance, the assassin bug. The name is so badass. Assassin bugs are from the Reduviidae family, and the family name isn't that intimidating. But at least the common name, apart from being so badass, it gives you an idea of how it works, how it behaves in the wild. Assassin man. There are likely many other advantages to common names, and I've only listed 4. If you can think of anything else, then why don't you share it in the comments? Now it's time to move over to the advantages of scientific names. The first advantage, of course, is that it is universal and it is standard. It is not affected by language, by tradition. It is the same across the board. The second advantage related to the first is that they are easy to organize and classify. If you recall the various levels of taxonomy, they go from very general to very specific. And in each level, in each classification, things are organized into something with common traits or something that they have similar with each other. And so by having an organized classification system, such as taxonomy, you would be able to determine the characteristics or traits of a specific plant by looking up its parentage or its lineage. Let's take the Sempervivum arachnoideum as an example. It is commonly known as cobweb houseleek. The scientific name is Sempervivum arachnoideum, which means its genus is Sempervivum and species is arachnoideum. The word Sempervivum comes from semper, or forever, and vivus, or living, literally forever living. Sempervivum are perennial plants, hence the name. Arachnoidium comes from the words arachnion, or spider, plus the suffix oides, which means resemble, literally spider-like. This is an obvious reference to the cobweb-like growth on the leaves. If you pay close attention to the Latin names, you will notice that the names are actually descriptive. The fourth advantage would be that it is precise. Each organism has only exactly one scientific name, so you cannot go wrong with any of that. For instance, when someone says cat, the meaning of that might depend on the context. For most people, it might mean the house cat, but for some people, it might mean lions, tigers, and by then you would have to qualify it as big cat or house cat or domestic cat. You know, there's so many meanings behind it. So those are just some of the advantages of each system. I'm sure you'll be able to think of more. Comments. Now, having listed all of these, it is now so easy to see the context and setting where each one would be appropriate. In everyday conversation, using common names would be best, switching only to scientific names if you need a degree of precision. If the people you're communicating with do not need to know the precise species, then common names it is. It also depends on who you're communicating with. If your circle is technical, then scientific names would be great. In this channel, I'm going to stick with scientific name or the correct published name wherever possible. But from time to time, there's no harm in using common names if that helps people understand what I'm talking about. There's no need to intimidate people with scientific names, especially if they're just learning. So in this case, it would be good to use both systems. Speaking of scientific names, if you want to learn more about how they work and how to write them, then you could check out the rest of the playlist. And with that said, thank you for watching. My name is Chuck. This has been Seriscapedia, where I'm doing my research so you don't have to. I'll see you in the next part, which would be about phenotypes and genotypes. Now, if you don't know what that means, I think it would be something interesting. I'll see you then. Bye.